Oh my God, oh God, if I could put it in words.
Man, that's a big question, you know? I don't think you can ask somebody like, what's the meaning of life, and you know, make it fit in a span that I'm filming, you know? It's just about the same thing. Glass is huge, so.
Well, I did a bunch of other materials before I tried glass. And there's something about the fact that if you can get it hot enough, you can make it into just about anything. And if you can keep it cold enough after that, it's gonna stay like that forever. So it can become anything.
It's like Michelangelo said, it's in there and it's just waiting to be set free.
It's magical, it's invisible, it's liquid, it's plastic, it's solid. It's crisp and geometric, it's organic and curvilinear, it's fluid, it's brittle, it's strong, it's delicate, it's all those different things, partly depending on what temperature it's at, of course, but it can blow up 10 minutes after having made it, or it can be the most archival of artistic substances. We've got pieces from 4,000 years ago that were made in the days of the pharaohs that are still brilliantly colored, which are made of glass. It's the material that lasts the longest of an artistic medium.
I mean, the translucency of glass, I mean, it's fascinating, the way it plays with light and the way you can shape it. The molten material, I mean, it gives you so many opportunities. So you can't resist it.
Glass is as close to being able to sculpt with light as anything else I've ever found.
Working glass occupies a place in time in a really tangible way. When you look at a glass object, a finished piece, you're looking at a moment captured in time. I love hot glass working because it's so dynamic and it is so dependent on specific actions that take place in a very limited amount of time. It's exactly like music in that regard. It's like sitting down and starting a piece of music. You can't just stop it and not have it be completely distorted and mangled. With glass, you start the work on the object, and 5 minutes later or 15 minutes later, however long it takes to make a piece, you have to continue this process smoothly throughout the entire period.
But the beauty of it, you know,
it's a pretty sexy material. Okay, flip.
Glass as material is, it's very sexy stuff.
Definitely a hot date.
Oh, I love it.
Oh, I've been madly in love with glass since I was 11 years old. I'm 56 now. I couldn't possibly tell you exactly why glass, but let me tell you that it is magical in a way that no other material is. When you're watching footage of these incredibly skilled glass artists, it's so deceptive. It looks so easy. There's never a false move. They move with great fluidity, and it is, in fact, incredibly difficult, everything they do. Keeping the piece on center is difficult, and they do that effortlessly. Pino seems to have the sensibilities of a Renaissance sculptor. He really has studied anatomy, that is, human anatomy, animal anatomy, botany. He seems to be a real connoisseur of the shape of things, of the way things are put together. And he pays a lot of attention to not only detail, but the big picture. From a distance, the object looks great. When you get up really close to it, it looks great. So there's this story that once Pino was teaching a workshop in a sort of an outdoor arrangement, and he was kept up all night by this terrible, terrible creature. So the next morning, Pino was trying to explain to people what this thing was. He speaks Italian, he doesn't speak any English. And so he wound up going to the furnace and sculpting this object, this thing, and it turned out that a raccoon had been harassing him all night. And the only way he could tell the people that it was a raccoon was by creating one out of glass. He'd never seen a raccoon before. He'd probably never imagined a raccoon. But that's a testament to the way he can see something or think of something and turn it into a piece of glass. It's amazing. There are a number of extremely fine sculptors of glass in Murano. Pino is arguably the very finest in that he has a huge range. He can make any kind of object you show him. And he has an apparently flawless technique for realizing anything he imagines or anything he sees.
Stupendous. Nobody handles glass like Pino Signoretto. Give him a pair of tweezers and a spatula and a knife, and he can make anything. He is the best sculptor in glass alive today.
Thank you.
Glass is a fantastic material. It's not like anything else. It's not even remotely like anything else that we use to make things with. For me, the magic happens when glass gets above about 1200 degrees Fahrenheit. Above about 1200 degrees Fahrenheit, glass gradually becomes less brittle, more and more plastic, up to the temperature of about 2000 degrees. It's a little bit runny, even. If you've never been in the same room with somebody working glass, there are a few things you're going to miss. One is that it's really hot. As you watch a video, there's a real focus on the glass itself and what's being done to it. But what you don't see is that there's a lot going on around it. Another thing is that this constant reheating is a very important part of the process, and it's essential to keep the glass soft and plastic and malleable. Pino loves to cover clear glass with powdered colored glass, or say with gold leaf, and very often it doesn't really look like glass. You might think it's clay, but one must never forget that this material is 1700 or 1800 degrees Fahrenheit, and that it can only be worked with these tools. You can't think about touching it, and it's always trying to drip off onto the ground. So you have all these things working against you, your inability to touch it. You have to do everything by remote control, so to speak. And it's cooling off real rapidly, so you have a very limited window of opportunity during which you can do these many things you have to do to create a sculpture. When you're watching videos of people blowing glass, it's not always apparent that every once in a while, every 30 seconds or every 15 seconds, they get up from the bench and they put the piece back in the glory hole to reheat it. Glass loses temperature really quickly. When glass is out in the air, it loses temperature by contact with the air, but also a much more efficient way of glass losing heat is by radiant transfer. That is to say, the glass glows and the energy is given off by radiant transfer. That's one of the reasons Pino covers his pieces in gold leaf. Of course, it looks better, but also it acts as a blanket, and it virtually stops the radiant loss. It makes the glass work much longer than it would if it were just bare of the gold covering. Throughout the processes, it's essential to keep every part of the object well over, let's say, 1,000 degrees Fahrenheit, because just below that, the glass can start to crack. And so a glass artist will put the object fully in the glory hole to even include the tip of the metal rod or blowpipe to which it's attached. And that's because if they don't, it'll start to crack and it'll drop on the floor. Everything starts the same way. It starts with dipping the end of a blowpipe or a punty into a furnace and gathering glass on the end of it. And the gather is just an amorphous mass of this hot material, and there's absolutely no evidence to tell you what it's going to be. The glass comes out of the furnace and it could turn into a horse, it could turn into a snail, it could turn into a goblet. There's no indication up front what's going to happen. That's part of the magic. And that's one of the things that makes it so fascinating watching glass working, because there is no evidence of what's coming. The only person who knows what's coming is Pino. When somebody as skilled as Pino works and you're watching them, it's very deceptive how hard it is. First of all, it's difficult to keep the mass of hot glass centered. If you notice, Pino flips things back and forth when he works. And that's because the glass sags as he stops to do a manipulation. And so he has to turn it over 180 degrees to get the arms back on center or the legs back on center. Everything's flopping around and it's a matter of keeping it under control. Well, if you've twirled honey on the end of a stick, getting it out of the jar, you know what this is like. It's very hard to keep it from dripping off, and it's darn near impossible to try to keep the mass of honey centered on the end of the gathering tool. Well, glass is the same. It's constantly heading for the floor, and you constantly have to work to compensate for that. And at the same time, of course, you have to manage what you're doing. One of the amazing things about Pino is that there are no false moves. Every time he touches the glass, it makes a meaningful change to the glass. And he does this in the context of not exactly struggling, but working against gravity, because gravity is going to destroy the piece and make it hit the ground if you don't do just the right thing to avoid it. Pino requires extremely skilled helpers to do what he does. There have to be people who at any given moment are ready to bring him a new bit of glass, perhaps clear glass, perhaps colored glass, possibly glass that's been rolled in powdered color or gold leaf. These people have to be very skilled, and Pino also works so quickly that they have to anticipate his needs. For example, the loincloth has to be prepared very carefully for it to pull off the metal rod as the band you see forming. The gold has to be put on heavily enough so that as it's pulled out, it doesn't disappear. These things take really serious skill to make. When you see Pino make a gesture, come here, that means that an assistant who maybe 2 or 3 minutes ago started preparing a part is being cued to come over. It's the right moment. And Pino expects that to be the right shape, the right temperature, have the right colored glass on it, or gold leaf. And that's the moment when the assistant has to be on the mark, 100%. As Icarus comes together, all of the parts, many of which have been made, an hour in advance, all the parts have to be just the right temperature. They have to be brought over at just the right moment. And that takes a huge amount of management skill from the assistants. All those parts are kept hot at about 1,000 degrees, and if they get a little bit too hot, they begin to distort, they're ruined. If they get a little bit too cool, they crack and they're useless. The head on the horse, all of these things have to be choreographed precisely. And putting the rider on the horse is an incredible feat. Everything has to come together at just the right moment, but that's not enough. They have to come together at just the right temperature also. If the parts aren't the right temperature, they're liable to crack, or they're liable to not stick. Again, it looks way too easy. It looks way, way too easy. If you go to a fantastic ballet performance or hear an incredibly skilled pianist, it looks so effortless, and it should look effortless, but the amount of work that went in to produce the effortlessness is unimaginable. One aspect of the magic of glass, and one of the things that fascinates people who get to watch it, is that it's so incredibly fast. It's faster than you can imagine. In real time, an object might take 30 seconds or 45 seconds to make. It might take as much as 15 minutes or 45 minutes. But glassworking processes are extremely fast. They're very dynamic, and that's one of the reasons they're so fascinating to watch. One of the most appealing things about glass is that it presents one with endless possibilities. You can make big, thick things, you can make thin, thin, light things, you can make long, narrow objects. There are no limits. With glass, the rewards are so great, and that's because it's so difficult. Years and years of struggle leave you with a fantastic technique and technical ability, but you can never completely control glass, so it remains endlessly fascinating. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Better watch, man. Poco vetro, eh. Nada. Vieni. Up. Up. Stop. 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 Stop.
Thank you. Perché non sto lavorando bene, non so fare. Thank you.
out in the front and in the back on the butt. It gives you this muscle right here. This body straight, because otherwise he'll, while he's working, he'll get it off and it'll get all crooked.
Gira. Nice.
maybe a pee-pee. Un poco de veros.